the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Welcome to Stone Temple United Methodist Church. I'm Yoo Jung Hwang, the pastor here. And even cold weather, and you came out today, and we have a worship service in this sanctuary that is great. Today is the first Sunday after Epiphany. Bring the worship. You may feel the presence of God and the Holy Spirit make awake your heart and mind so that you may worship God in the spirit and in truth. Let us prepare our minds and souls for the worship today.
Thank you.
Tim.
I got some good news this week. My friend, Dr. Zan Maria, who's been on a prayer list for a while, who had brain cancer, has been doing pretty well in recovery and actually got to come out to the gun club this week, and we look forward to shooting with him again. He's coming back again. This will be his fifth bout of cancer.
Praise God. Praise God. Wonderful. Anyone else? Ronnie.
I'd just like to keep them in your prayers for the family of Bobby Jones, for firefighters who recently lost his battle with COVID. And also, I think I should keep in mind that in our prayers for the family of the firefighters in Baltimore City that lost their lives.
Yeah,
if you've never been a firefighter, you don't know what it is. I mean, far from you, there are one big happiness, one big family. I won't say their happiness.
Yeah.
Sue.
Mom's birthday is this
Wednesday. That's right. Wonderful.
That's all right. I should have lost your favorite bag. Happy birthday. Children running around. It was just glorious. I praise God for the wonderful family he's given me. Any others?
Generous God, in Christ, you embrace people of every time and place for the Holy Church of God. For those who lead the ministry of the church, and for all who follow the way of Jesus. This time, we lift up the names of the fallen firefighters, and we light the candle for them. their name Paul Burton, Bertrand, Kesley Settler, and Kenny Lacayo, and injured firefighter John McMaster, were trapped in the abandoned row house when it collapsed on them. Lord, help us remember their sacrifice and courage. Live out every day by our public servants. May your comfort and peace be upon the family and their friends and the community. Lord, we pray for hundreds of thousands of people are without power because of a winter storm. Lord, keep them safe from this freezing cold weather, and may your protection be upon them, and they may get power soon. We pray for children, students, teachers, and staff, parents, grandparents, and doctors, nurses, and the front workers for their safety and health. God of compassion, we remember before you the poor and the afflicted, the sick and the dying, prisoners and all who are lonely, the victim of war, injustice, and inhumanity, and all others who suffer from whatever their sufferings. I lift up the names. Dennis, who has cancer, and then Bob John. Also, I lift up the Joy Cole. She's going to have eye surgery on Monday. Lord, may your healing hands be upon them so that they can be a speed recovery. Lord, we praise the Lord for some goodness in our lives and celebration and joys in our lives. Thank God, Dr. Zemaria, he is getting better and he came out and have fellowship with others. And also, the Dwight, his great-granddaughter's baptism. And also, the family gatherings yesterday, oh, that was really great joy for the Christmas celebration, and they enjoyed it to have a fellowship with family. Thank you so much for joys and blessings in our lives, Lord. Author of grace and God of love, send your Holy Spirit's blessing to your children here. Keep our hearts and thoughts in Jesus Christ, our Savior, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, So it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free. And we were all given one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now if the foot should say, because I am a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with such special honor. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty. While our presentable parts need no special treatment, but God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. We stand for the song response, please.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Loving God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered at this time. Bless each one of us and open our hearts and ears so that we can take your words into our hearts. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and redeemer. In your holy name I pray. Amen. Jesus went to his town, Nazareth, and read from the scroll of Isaiah. He says, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, and set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." It was Jesus' mission statement. He came for the poor, the prisoner, the blind, and the oppressed. He came to proclaim the good news to those who were marginalized. You know what? This is not only Jesus' mission, but also is our mission as well. Our mission as the church is to share good news with poor, the prisoner, the blind, and the oppressed, physically and spiritually. Some of you might have a question. Should we share good news to only those people? No. The church ministers to all people. So, how can we do that? We, as a church, work by the Spirit. In Luke, Jesus mentioned Isaiah, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news." The same Spirit of the Lord is upon us, and we are commissioned by the power of the Holy Spirit. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can share the news and do the ministry for the kingdom of God. We are commissioned by the Holy Spirit. It starts to our home, our community, and in the world. And then secondly, as the church, we are body of Christ. It is made up of many members. Christ is the head of the church. Christ is the unifying power that keeps the body together. In this role, he helps things, guides, and directs the body. Each member is different, and each has been given different gifts. Some have been given the gifts of preaching and teaching, and some others have been given the gift of healing, and some people are good leaders, and have been given the gift of seeing that everything runs smoothly. And some people have the gifts of organization to make a plan, run the events. And some people have given the gifts of solution of conflicts. And some people may have given the gifts of helping others. At Stone Chapel, we have many events and we have some council. So we have bluegrass and loves and fish and SWAT and council and men's group. And you all involve and to participate in the body of Christ, what we have been doing, and you have used the gifts to build up this church. And we have someone who are gift, have a DJ, so who runs and every Sunday morning till we can hear the radio. Just as God gave us hands, feet, head, eyes, ears, to meet the needs of the whole body. God has given the church different members with the different gifts to meet the needs of the whole church. Do you believe God has called called you as a children of God? Do you believe you are called to be part of the body of Christ? If you say yes, what part of the body of Christ are you called to be? Hand, foot, eye, ear? Do you know you have a gift from God as a part of the body of Christ? If you are here today, even though you do not know yet what gifts you have gotten from God, you already have received these gifts from God. Do you remember your calling story from God? How did you become a Christian? I'm not talking about how you came to church, but how you received Jesus Christ as your Savior, how you came to know Jesus personally, and how you have a relationship with Jesus personally. I think I shared with you this several times, but I would like to share my story with you. My calling story seems like a curved path. I ran away from God and came back to God. I grew up in a Christian family because my mother became Christian when I was 4 years old. Mostly, I got my Christian education from Sunday school and my mother. In my teenage years, I really enjoyed going to church, and I was eager to know more and more. So when I became a senior in high school, I decided to study Christian education as my major in Methodist Theological University in South Korea. After studying Christian education, students mostly get a job related to the church, such as a children's ministry, a youth director, or assistant pastor, and so on. But somehow, I lost my interest in getting a job related to Christian life or the church. So after graduating, I got a job in an advertising company, so I worked there for 3 years. One day, I thought about my future. Even though I was satisfied with my job and salary, I thought that something was missing in my life. I had an empty feeling inside of me. I began looking for the purpose of my life. Why am I here on earth? What is the purpose of my life? I came to know that I was not concerned about money, but I wanted to work for God. I wanted to figure out what the work might be, and I shared my thoughts with my mother, who is a prayer warrior. She invited me to pray to God for 100 days. So I prayed for 100 days with my mother at church in the early morning before going to work, and in the evening after coming home, about God's direction for my future. Finally, God gave me answer from the Word of God, the Bible. It was Isaiah chapter 43:1. It says, "Do not be afraid, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." So I believe that I had a vision for the glory of God, but I did not know exactly what it was. After I got the answer from God, I was searching for what God wanted me to do. During my search, I had a chance to go to the U.S. and to learn English, and I quit working for the advertising company, and then came to the U.S. When I came to the U.S. in 2003 as a single person, I studied English first. While I was studying English, I had a chance to serve the church as a volunteer for the director of youth. While I was serving the church and the youth, I realized that God was calling me to God's ministry because I felt that very happy when I serve God and others at the church. I pray to God about that, and God reminded me of God's calling in Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 1. When I shared that one with my senior pastor, he encouraged me to go to seminary and affirm my calling. After this experience, I made up my mind to minister and to attend Wesley Theological Seminary in D.C. During study at Wesley Seminary, I was clear about my calling from God, so that I began the process of entering ordained ministry in Baltimore Washington Conference in 2007. It took 10 years to become ordained a minister as an elder in the United Methodist Church. Therefore, I believe God has been calling me as a pastor to serve the people of God. I remember when my first gathering with the district committee of ministry as a candidate, the deacon gathering closed with worship, and we sang together the hymn, "Here I Am, Lord." Still, I remembered, while I was singing the hymn, my heart was strangely warm, and I was convinced that I was called by God. Still, the hymn reminds me of my calling from God. Since I came to the U.S., my faith journey has had ups and downs and hills and valleys in my life here. When I came to the U.S., I was single, only beginning to learn English, as I shared before with you. At the time, my English was very poor, so I could only say simple words such as hello and thank you. That's it. I could not go to seminary until I learned to speak English better. I'm still learning English and working to improve my pronunciation and get rid of my Korean accent. As part of the body of Christ, I'm working with you to see God's kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. I believe as a part of God's, the Christ's body, I have been called to be a pastor. And how about you? To what part of Christ's body have you been called? What gifts do you have from God? I believe you have an answer in yourself already. And if you don't have the answer yet, I believe that you just do not realize yet the gift that you already have been given by God. God has called us to be God's children. Each one of us is called because God loves us, and God invites us to be part of Christ's body. Are you willing to answer yes to this invitation? If you say yes, what part of the body are you willing to be? God gives each one of us special gifts. I pray that when you hear God's calling in your heart, and you will answer to God like this: "Here I am, Lord. I will go. If you lead me, I will hold your people in my heart." Amen.
Back to God the little of what he has given to us.
special collection was taken at the time.
Hope you remember the day that I think she was here, wasn't she?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That would be a collection to support her and her missions work. The Zion Church that is selling the discount cards, they're still available.
And if you're interested, maybe you know what they still have, but
yes, they still have it. Yes.
And we've used ours quite a bit, so they are worthwhile. You do save some money.
Is, yeah.
6-week Lenten Bible study on Wednesday will be starting on March 9th. If you're interested, the book costs $13.99, and you can make a check payable to Stone Chapel Church. The book is titled The Lord's Prayer. The classes will start on February 13th. Council meeting. It will be the next council meeting. It's March 24th at 7 p.m. And a big thank you to those who helped out the mission of the loaves and fishes. I understand it went very well. Again, it was held outside, but they seem to still come. And they appreciate all that you do, I'm sure. Any other announcements?
Yes, I appreciate Ms. Carroll leading today, and February for leadership and church support is sadly blank. So here I am with this book, and please see me if you would like to help out during a church service. Nothing to it, right, Ms. Carroll?
Nothing to it.
See that?
That's good.
So just stand up here and think everybody's in their underwear. Okay, no other announcements. That shall be stand for the doxology.
congregation. Dear brothers and sisters, Dear brothers and sisters, Jesus' mission is our mission. We are part of the body of Christ who share God's love and grace. Go into the world with the power of the Holy Spirit who has anointed you and commissioned you. And share God's love and grace at your home, in the community, and in the world. In the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.
Thank you.